I was fascinated by the country as such. I flew north from Churchill to Coral Harbor on Southampton Island at the end of September. Snow had begun to fall, and the country was partially covered by it. Some of the lakes were frozen around the edges, but towards the center of the lake you could still see the clear, clear water. And flying over this country, you could look down and see various shades of green in the water, and you could see the bottom of the lakes, and it was a most fascinating experience. I remember I was up in the cockpit with a pilot, and I was forever looking out, left and right, and I could see ice floes over the Hudson's Bay, and I was always looking for a polar bear or some seals that I could spot, but unfortunately there were none. And as we flew along the east coast of Hudson's Bay, this flat,
I don't go, let me say this again, I don't go for this Northmanship bit at all.
Because it just seemed endless.
I don't...
We seemed to be going into nowhere.
Not those people who do claim that
and
they
the further north we went,
farther north and so
the more
on.
Monotonous.
But I see it as a kind of a game, this Northmanship bit, with people saying, well, you know, were you ever up at the North Pole? You know, and hell, I did a dog sled trip of 22 days, and the other fellow comes up, well, I did one of 30 days.
No, for another 11 years.
Perhaps they would see themselves as more
sure, the North has changed my life. I can't conceive of anyone being in close touch with the North, whether he lived there all the time or simply traveled it month after month and year after year. I can't conceive of such a person being really untouched by the North for the rest of his life. When I left in 1965, at least left the job there,
it goes on like this, as though there's some special merit, some
north,
virtue to being in the North, or some special virtue
as keen as ever.
In having been with the primitive people.
What
special virtue was there in that?
It is most difficult to describe.
I find
it was extreme isolation. This is very true. And I knew very well I could not go anywhere except for a mile or two walking. I always think of the long summer night
when
snow had melted. The lakes were open, and the geese and ducks had started to fly. During that time, the sun would set, but when there was still the last shimmer in the sky, I would walk out to one of those lakes and watch those ducks and geese just fly around peacefully or sitting on the water. And I felt that I was almost part of that country, part of that peaceful surrounding, and I wished that it would never end.
Are we right to open
the mass media, which incidentally,
the real truth about the North, for me as a North, because of the fact that whenever I spoke to
them, they opened up on the first white man of his supreme confidence towards the rest of the world. First adventure in
this is Glenn Gould, and this program is called The Idea of North. I've long been intrigued by that incredible tapestry of tundra and taiga which constitutes the Arctic and subarctic of our country. I've read about it, written about it, and even pulled up my parka once and gone there. Yet, like all but a very few Canadians, I've had no real experience of the North. I've remained, of necessity, an outsider. And the North has remained for me a convenient place to dream about, spin tall tales about, and in the end, avoid. This program, however, brings together some remarkable people who have had a direct confrontation with that northern third of Canada, who've lived and worked there, and in whose lives the North has played a very vital role. There's a geographer and anthropologist, Jim Lotz, a sociologist, Frank Valley, a government official, Bob Phillips, and a nurse, Marianne Schrader. There's also a fifth character, and therein lies a story. Several years ago, I went north aboard a train known affectionately to Westerners as the Muskeg Express, Winnipeg to Fort Churchill, 1,015 miles, 2 nights, 1 day, 4 double bedrooms, 8 sections, diner, and coach. And at breakfast, I struck up a conversation with one W.V. McLean, or as he was known along the line and at all the hamlet sidings where his bunk car would be parked, Wally. Wally McLean is a surveyor, now retired, and within the first minutes of what proved to be a day-long conversation, he endeavored to persuade me of the metaphorical significance of his profession. He parlayed surveying into a literary tool, even as Jorge Luis Borges manipulates mirrors and Franz Kafka badgers beetles. And as he did so, I began to realize that his relation to a craft which has as its subject the land enabled him to read the signs of that land, to find in the most minute measurement a suggestion of the infinite, to encompass the universal within the particular. And so when it came time to organize this program and to correlate the disparate views of our four other guests, I invited Wally McLean to be our narrator and to tell me how, in his view, one can best attain an idea of the North.
Well, the only way I see this happening is in an extended ride north. When I say that, I mean a long, terrible, trying trip, perhaps to Churchill, by way of Thompson, going and coming, past Ilford and Gillam, this long, almost trans-Siberian experience that we now face. And for those that face it, perhaps for the first or second or third time, there's almost a traumatic experience. They feel, this is going to become impossible. It may not be now, but it's going to become. And yet they are able to do little or nothing about it. What finally, you ask, is done about it? Well, here's my guess. What really happens is this. The train is about to leave the paw, say, a specific point. And 510 miles away north and east is going to be Churchill a day later. And what does the person do on leaving the paw? Do you know what happens? He sits there in the day coach. The newsie is just ahead of him. And these people, the conductor and the brakeman and so forth, who are accustomed to this, are sort of making nothing of it. He sits there wondering, oh, this is going to be forever. It's already been a day, now it's going to be another day, and what about this one? Before long, he's going to have to, perhaps, say hello and, pass the odd word to his fellow man. And indeed, it isn't long before, well, we've heard what he has to say, why, for the first time, he's going north. With what? Well, with the army. With the Navy, with the Air Force, with these initials that he always throws at you, DPW, what's that? Oh, Department of Public Works. With DRNL, what's that? What is it? Defense Research Northern Laboratories? What's that? Well, you're studying the Northern Lights then. Well. Now you can listen for a while. Because what do any of us know about the Northern Lights?
Well, like I think quite a large number of people who end up in the north, I sort of got there by mistake. I strayed in there. I think my first attempt to go north was when, during a summer vacation when I was at university in England, I thought about going to Iceland. I'm not too sure why. And instead, because I made a mistake about the fare, I ended up in Morocco. I'm a geographer by training, and I have this belief, you see, that geographers are people who have no sense of direction, just as sociologists are people who don't like society, and economists are people who can't really manage their own money, though some evidence in the north indicates they have a pretty good time with the public purse. I came to Canada after I'd been in West Africa for a year. I came to Canada again, like so many other immigrants, because I could get a job in England. I came to Ottawa to place my services at the disposal of the federal government, and the federal government had other ideas. So after working in a few dead-end jobs in Ottawa, the advertising, copywriting things, I applied to McGill and was encouraged to go north to the McGill Sephardic Research Laboratory to do some fieldwork for the thesis. The thesis was on soils and agricultural possibilities in the Knob Lake area, PQ. There isn't a great deal of soil, and as far as I can make out, there are no agricultural possibilities. This is what's known as negative evidence in science. And I began to get the impression that the North is a land of very narrow, very thin margins. Man, of course, is a biological improbability at the best of times. If you wanted to design something that could live on this earth, you wouldn't design a man. And in the North, in many respects, we're at our sort of greatest and our most grotesque.
He's sitting there, sort of away from the madding crowd that's stampeding up and down the aisles, and actually, he's trying to sort of isolate himself, because in fact, shortly, he will be isolated for a long period of time in the lonely north.
Just about the time that I was was finishing off my thesis on Knob Lake, the phone rang, and Dr. Sven Orvik, then with the Department of Geography at McGill, asked me if I'd like to go north on an Arctic expedition. And of course, being English, I said yes. There are several traditions of Arctic expeditions. The English tradition is where everybody puts £50 in the pot and sort of hires husky dogs from Greenland and lives on Bovril and Ovaltine and this sort of thing. And then there's the American tradition where you have a massive before operations report and a massive after operations report, but very little in the middle. I was to undergo an American Arctic expedition, and I use the term undergo as of an operation advisedly. So Sven Orvik phoned me up, said, do you want to go on an Arctic expedition? And I said, well, certainly. And I was even sort of tickled to death to find out they were going to pay me for this. Memory, of course, tends to cast a pall over our worst and best experiences. But looking back at this, this is one of the experiences of my life. A group of men isolated, each trusting the other and each respecting the other. A small community in isolation. And it's not just sort of a touch of the old nostalgia. It's a feeling of having participated in something very meaningful, both personally and professionally.
You know what one young fellow told me that was taking, I forget what he was taking, probably philosophy. He said this was the myth of Sisyphus. As a matter of fact, he lisped, but I didn't, I think. And the fact is that he had quite a time with it, and here was some wretched, was it a king? Was it a king? Yes. A king of Greece, Corinth. Well, it might have been Corinth. And here he was rolling this confounded rock up to the top of this precipice for some reason or other. And then he let gravity take over, and it hit the bottom. And he did the same thing again, no doubt with a larger rock.
I went back to the north with an American expedition to northern Ellesmere Island. This was to the ice shelf of northern Ellesmere Island, even further north than I'd been in 57 and 58. Now, this was a fairly ghastly experience. I always remember that on the Canadian expedition, we'd eaten dried meats and this sort of thing, and we'd enjoyed ourselves, you know. Somebody says, well, you know, when you go on these Arctic expeditions, don't you start missing women? Well, after about the first month, then you start talking about food. Remember once I had American private first class with me as an assistant. At least I think he was working for me. And they dropped one of the tracks, and they also very kindly dropped us some lettuce and some tomatoes. And I said, my goodness, look at this. Fresh vegetables. And he said, no salad dressing. Anyhow, the whole thing was a shambles and a mess. The scientific results were minimal. The whole experience was rather frustrating and disagreeable. Of course, it may have been me who accepted this about the North. And I was worried about whether it's you or whether it's the country, the other people.
Wow. Is this a surprise? No, it's no surprise at all. The person that makes the trip, more often, of course, is going to realize that before long he's going to be up against himself. Not against his fellow travelers, no, so much, but he's going to have to be up against his own sad self.
I'd always sort of wanted to work with people in the North. And in 1960, I transferred to the Department of Northern Affairs and National Resources as a community planning officer. The first thing I was asked to undertake was a study of the squatters of Whitehorse. These were a group of people who ultimately, at least in my own work, turned out to be a key to the way that the North is viewed in Canada, the way the North can, may, and has developed.
Well,
these people had a tremendously
somehow the sameness
bad reputation.
Of a trip in
I was told by all
and
northern
a trip
hands
out
that when I went up to the
is part of this endless feeling that we are up against this
Yukon
myth, this business
dead.
Of having to do things for
all these sorts of
for no
hairy
apparent
stories
reason.
About the wicked squatters. Well, I
Fine.
Found, of course, that
you say to yourself,
these were a bunch of
well,
people
which of these
the
people I've seen now
in an area whose economic future
am I going to say hello to?
Uncertain.
Well, it isn't as though you've lasted that long. You've said hello to half a dozen, maybe 15. But you had no intention to sort of establish, what is that they call it?
They lived as
rapport
well as they could.
With anyone in particular.
I know it's
now
kind
you
of
find
cliche,
it necessary.
Some of my best friends
isn't that funny?
Have been
you find
squatters.
It necessary. Why, in fact?
Well, I did this study and I came back alive, shattering the myth of the wicked squatters who wouldn't talk to anybody from Ottawa. Of course, they hate Ottawa in the North. They just loathe Ottawa.
I guess my love affair with the North went back about, more than 15 years. I was in the East Block then, as a young officer in the Department of External Affairs. And in the course of my work, it gradually sort of bore into me that Canadians were, well, if not throwing away their north for a mess of pottage, at least being supremely oblivious to the responsibilities we had to the people there, and I suppose oblivious, too, to the resources, the wealth that we could get from it. We just didn't care about the north. It was a great sort of terra nullius. And I got kind of frustrated about this, and naturally more and more anxious that we and the government should do something about our responsibilities in the north.
And I came back and came back alive and brought back the list of the people, and from that time on I was entitled to call myself a northern expert. Again, the joke about the word expert being derived from two words, ex meaning formerly and spurt meaning a drip under pressure, is by no means inappropriate in the north. Really, as a matter of fact, you can't talk about the north until you've got out of it. So the definition is not all that incorrect.
Well, the end of 1953 was the beginning of the sort of administrative revolution in the north. Now, not everything started then. A lot of things had started before, and a lot of things were far from starting. But at least there was the focus of the department, and it was decided to make a new investment in the north.
Well, then I did a series of what you call quick and dirty studies. I was up in Inuvik, and I wrote a wrong report with a very large number of recommendations. Again, this is par for the course in the north. You come from Ottawa, you go in the north, you write a report, you make a list of recommendations, you bring it back to Ottawa, and nobody pays any attention to it.
Wasn't an easy decision. But eventually I decided that I would sit for a competition for a job in Northern Affairs. And therefore, in 1954, I moved over, changed my life, as you might say, and then did something serious about the love affair with the North.
In 1962 to 66, I spent the summers in the Yukon. I mounted a Yukon research project, started wondering about the future of Whitehorse, started looking at the future of the Yukon, then from there, the future of the North, the future of North America, and the future of the world. I sort of kind of stopped there. This brought me literally, oh blessed man, in contact with Buckminster Fuller.
He had to tell somebody this business sort of about his research and his hopes, and he's a young fellow and so forth and so on. You don't want to smash his dream before it has dimensions.
First of all, what sort of a world we're in, and secondly, what sort of a world we're moving into. The other thing, of course, about the North is it is an oral society. There is a great stress right on this.
Because he's got one of these social scientific minds. I feel embarrassed at telling him or suggesting to him that there's something more than figures and quantitative things and measurable things that enter into the whole picture of how you get along with yourself. Or if you get along with yourself. It seems to me that a man by the name of Pascal, years back, said that most of mankind's troubles would be over with or done away with if he would stay in his own room. At the time, I thought this was such a self-evident, banal, a sort of, silly thing to say that I gave it little thought. But then, on looking back, perhaps after few decades, I thought to myself, how indeed true this is. Can a man get along with himself, usually, in this solitary life of the hermit north, or the solitary life of any place where he secludes himself?
I didn't think it was eccentric to go north. Many people who knew me thought it was. They couldn't see my point at all. They didn't think it was a country for a woman, especially for a single woman, because they thought about the social life there and thought that when a woman reaches a certain age, she should be far more concerned with trying to trap a man than with making a career for herself or with trying to face the world by herself.
I think it takes a strong person to live in the north and really to be a part of it and to find satisfaction there. When you're living in the big city in the south, you can always retreat. When you fail in your relations with society, you can just go away and nobody really knows the difference. You can't go away when you're in a little village 1,000 miles from nowhere and a couple of weeks from the next plane, high in the Arctic.
You can only leave with the knowledge of many other people. You can't say, I'll take the weekend off and I'll go to the next motel and I'm not to be disturbed. This is impossible.
And so all sorts of curious things happen. In some ways, you may have gone to the north to get away from society, and you find yourself far closer to it than you've ever been in your life. You know your neighbors intimately. You know each walk they take down that little 500-yard road. You know what their problems are because they're bound to talk to you about them. If they don't, they'll go nuts just as you'll go nuts when you don't talk.
It just isn't possible to escape from gossip, for instance. We at Coral Harbor knew what was going on at Baker Lake, or at Eskimo Point, or at Rankin Inlet, not by official communication, but because it all came more or less by a grapevine. It was absolutely impossible to keep anything from anybody, even if we had a party they knew at dawn in Winnipeg.
And yet, the kind of people you have chosen as your friends and associates in that particular village, in that sort of desert island of the north, if you like, are not people that you've really chosen at all.
You get a conglomeration of white people in the north, and you don't choose to live with them. You go there and you find them, or they come and find you.
Sometimes you'll find yourself, rather pathetically perhaps, persuading yourself that this is great. And you'll sit on a Saturday night in the kind of couch that you'll see in every village of the north, from Baffin Island to the Mackenzie Delta. They're all identical in the government houses. And you'll get in a sing-song with the trader and his wife and the priest or the other missionary, the policeman, and so on. And you'll sing the same sort of songs, whether in Baffin Island or the Mackenzie Delta. And you'll exchange the same sort of gossip about so-and-so who's just moved from this store to that, or Dr. So-and-so who's probably coming through on the next flight 10 days, and so on. And you convince yourself that this is really the life, that there's a kind of precious intimacy about all this.
I didn't have to go to somebody in Coral and say I'm lonesome or I'm depressed. I just had to go and visit them, play a game of chess, whatever they wanted to do, and right away there was a sense of sharing this life. One could realize the value of another human being.
You're excluding the rest of the world that will never understand, and you've made your own world with these other people. And probably what you'll never know, and what nobody else will ever know, is whether you're kidding yourself or not. Have you really made your peace with these other people, or have you made a peace because the only alternative to the peace is a kind of crack-up?
I was, in many respects, solitary, but in a strange way, the North has made me more sort of gregarious. Because the North does show you exactly how much you rely on your fellow man, what the sense of community means. The sense of community in the North, unlike in the South, is a matter of life and death. The thing about the North, of course, in personal terms, is that in the North you feel it's so big, it's so vast, it's so immense, it cares so little. And this sort of diminishes you. And then you think, my God, I am here. I've got here, I live here, I live, I breathe, I walk, I laugh, I have companions.
I found that the wide open spaces concept isn't quite what it's cracked up to be. I felt cooped in the wide open spaces, because I was so afraid to get lost that the environment around me, while being vast in the physical sense, one could see theoretically for 1,000 miles, because there was nothing in the way to block your view, it was surrounded on each side by dangers. Dangers, for instance, of getting lost. This was, to me, the biggest danger of all.
There's a wonderful cliche, which I hope I may be forgiven for mentioning once more, that a nation is great only as long as it has a frontier. Now, we've got that frontier. Other people are nostalgically having to dip back 100 years to find their frontier and vicariously become part of it. We've got it. And we have a very, very small percentage of our population who really take advantage of it in the specific physical way. But for a lot of the rest of us, it is a sort of frontier and much more than a physical sense. Now, this does something to the Canadian character. It means we've got a kind of civilization that does not conform to the rest of North America. Here is a place where nonconformists can live and flourish. The kind of person who goes to the North is rather odd. And if you're smart, you'll go on looking for this kind of odd person.
I'm afraid it's not very romantic, you know, my wanting to go up there to find myself or to lose myself or all these various reasons that people give for going into the North. The fact that they're North gives them some extra kudos, I guess. They feel, what a sacrifice I'm making for Canada up here. But perhaps I'm a bit cynical. I don't go for this kind of stuff. But you do get a deliberate building up of a kind of cult of personality. You get lots of people attempting to create a style of their own, to be known as characters. And this is wonderful. I'm all for it. Some people say, well, it's hypocritical. Oh, the heck with that. This is good. People should have styles. You get a lot of these old-timers especially. Well, I mind the time when I was, you know, 40 days without food and so on. This becomes part of the front and the stance that nothing can shake us. And we are down-to-earth people. And it's a cup of tea in your hand the minute you stick your head in the door. And if I had a bottle, the last bottle, and no plane coming in, you know, for 6 months, I'd still split this bottle with you, because this is the way we are in the North. There's a lot of that going on. That is, to some extent, stereotypes. Although, like most stereotypes, people get to believe that this is the way they are, even if that's not the way they were when they first went in. They come to believe this, as, you know, Pirandello and others point out, you come to believe in your own role.
Oh, well, there's no question about this. There's such a thing as being a hermit by choice rather than being a hermit by necessity. Now, it all depends on whether you think you're answering a challenge or escaping from yourself. Are you, in fact, escaping in any real way by retreating north, or by retreating perhaps in any direction? You know, I like to think of myself as part of Shakespeare's, what was that? Sweet are the uses of adversity, you see? I like to think that when I'm stuffed away up north in some forlorn place where there's not a section house, or there's not a, perhaps more than the odd wolf or dog team within a long distance, I like to think that I'm getting along with myself. Not only that I'm getting along with myself, but that I understand the problems that are, not the problems that I create. You see, I think we all create then our own problems, and if we haven't got some to discuss, that we would sooner be kicked than remain unnoticed.
Show children in Alaska on the Kuskokwim looking at a television set for the first time, and what they were seeing on the television set were themselves. They had a closed circuit rigged up. I suppose, you know, in Einstein's term, if space is curved and we ever get our eyesight up or our missiles up or our messages up, you know, maybe we'll sort of be seeing the back of our heads. I think this is part of the North. It's important, like with the gold seekers. I remember an old Swede who probably hadn't even read Robert Service, and he spread some gold out for me. They keep their little nuggets, and he said, take some gold. And I said, I can't take your gold. He says, no, he says, it's not the gold. He says, it's the finding the gold. And I think the North is process. The North is finding, and no, not so much finding, so much as seeking. My experience with the North has enriched me immeasurably. I've enjoyed it. I've liked it. I've done some very foolish things there.
I suppose that any perceptive person who wanders about the North and gets to know the Northerners a little bit is bound to have some of his old illusions shattered. If his illusions are based on the kind of romantic approach that we traditionally got from the books and the schoolroom, the stories, I mean, about the lovely Eskimos and their gleaming white igloos and how life is simple and unspoiled and unchanged and so on. Well, that kind of life is really ugly, ugly, ugly. And you can't have all your illusions about the charming old life when you go up and see the tuberculosis and when you see the wretched health conditions, the wretched living conditions, the unspeakable sanitation. When you see the racial distinctions between a sort of white master race and the lesser breeds that have always been kept just a little outside the law. I'm not blaming anybody for this, unless I blame us all collectively. But there's a lot in that romantic tradition that, in my mind, was pretty ugly, judged by today's standards.
Yes, it did seem like a very romantic place to me, and this was one of the reasons why I wanted to go north. Because considering a place romantic means that one doesn't know too much about it. I had read a great deal about it, and it sounded very, very romantic to me. And I suppose, in a way, I was influenced by this. And when I arrived, it was a cold September day. It was snowing in Coral Harbor, and there was absolutely no one there to meet me. I stepped off the plane, and then there were a number of rugged-looking men with beards, wearing heavy parkas and boots. And here was I, this frail little girl from Winnipeg who came to the north to help the Eskimos. And at that moment, I think I was more in need of help than anyone else. I felt absolutely lost.
I don't know. I think that it's something like marriage, I guess. A person who romanticizes or idealizes his girlfriend, right? And refuses to, quote, see reality, as his parents say, well, look, you know, her teeth are falling out, and so on. A person refuses to see this and insists on marrying the girl, discovers after a while that, you know, the parents were right, perhaps. and so he gets disenchanted, right?
I must be out of my mind to come to this place. What will I do here? What is my purpose? Am I really doing the right thing? And I was a little shaken.
I've seen people who are disenchanted with the North simply withdraw and concentrate in some activity, like collecting guns or stamps or, you know, whatever, and sort of withdrawing into a cocoon and just going through the motions in almost a ritual way. I've seen other people who've turned against their employers or against the government, for instance, and say, well, you know, if it weren't for them, everything would be all right, and hit out at Ottawa, that kind of thing. Other people turned against those that they came to help, and these stupid Eskimos are still in the Stone Age, and so on and so on. You get this variety of reactions, and the most common one, of course, is simply to take off and say, well, I think I'll try Africa or some other place where the people need me.
When I came south, I felt I'd had it. I'd been at Coral Harbor for many months without a break, and this was just too much for me. I felt that I wasn't able to work effectively. I just didn't want any part of the North any longer. But now, looking back on it, I think I would like to go North again. Because although there are many disadvantages, just that life's so big, streets, etc. Sometimes I've been lonelier in a city than I ever was in the North.
Moved on in ugly ways. I'm not suggesting everything about the new life in the North is good. Heaven knows there are ugly problems. The alcoholism is talked about a lot. It's probably talked about more as a disease than a symptom, and it should be talked about as a symptom of the contradictions in society. Alcoholism has a lot to do with the sort of protest, the articulate protest of those whose voices were once silent about their place in life. That's ugly. However, we are moving forward. When I was first associated with the administration of the North, one of our sort of heartbreaking tasks was to add up how many Canadian citizens had starved to death in that season. And we used to all keep a sort of chart on the wall of the starvation and hope to heavens that the curve would go down. Well, thank heavens, with all the ugliness that there is in the North today, let's remember that that chart is showing a downward curve. In fact, I think it's some years since we've had outright starvation in the North.
First of all, It seems to me that in the North we're seeing one of the final playings out of those two great dreams of man, Eldorado or Utopia. Both Eldorado and Utopia were always located in parts unknown. I mean, it's very difficult to sort of think of Utopia down in Toronto, for instance, with all due deference to Toronto. We know too much about it. We have too much of an understanding of the reality. But north of 60, it's still empty. It's still, in many ways, the land of the possible. And so we have the story of either A, the rich north, the vast treasure house of literature, which, you know, like making me, in Dorothy Parker's terms, sort of foe up, or B, the vast, great, empty, useless desert. To me, the north is so Canadian. André Siegfried mentioned this about a window on the future, a potential future. He was writing in 1937, well before most Canadians woke up to the reality of the North. I've seen the shape of a possible future in the North, and quite frankly, it scares the hell out of me. Prospero in the Tempest could only be Prospero simply because he had Caliban to do all the dirty work. And he points out the sort of a kind of a symbiosis in these colonial situations where we think, you know, we're helping the Eskimo, we're doing things for the Eskimo, and, you know, he should be grateful to us. And we feel that we are, you know, in a sense, manipulating him. We don't seem to realize there's another end to this, that he is manipulating us. We have some detailed evidence on this in George River. That, you know, because we say, the wonderful Eskimo,
which at that time was quite a place to which Eskimos were moving, I don't know if you're familiar with it.
And he won't play this only insofar as it sort of keeps us happy.
A few hundred working in the mines.
I think there's something fairly insidious about this.
And there was a great deal of dispute going on as to whether this
Well, in our impatience, and the hour here, I think, is the people of Canada, or people of Canada who have some interest in the North.
In their nature to observe the...
I think we've often tended to do a disservice to Northerners by putting them in places they shouldn't quite be. That is, putting them in places they haven't earned themselves. Putting them in places which we hope they will earn themselves.
Debates, that is, about
there's a tendency at times to show one's respectability anywhere on this continent by having on your board of directors a tame Negro or a tame female or a tame Indian.
Any white woman who goes north has a very specific purpose. Usually she's married to a man who is with the Department of Northern Affairs or whatever. So the wife accompanies her husband. She probably has a number of small children.
We're terribly good fellows and broad-minded, we whites, and we do want to turn things over to Eskimos. So come and sit on our board, so to speak. I don't literally mean a board, of course. And then... there's such a tendency for the Eskimo, the Northern Indian, to be a kind of showpiece, a doll, a puppet. And this doesn't do anybody any good. Because those who are sitting quietly back on the rock watching all this say, you see, those fellows never know anything. How can they discuss a budget? Heavens, they're not understanding anything at all. They're just serving as the sort of stooges for you whites who have all the power.
Because the Eskimo society is
definitely a patriarchy. The dilemmas.
The Nunamnut, the people who live on the land, resist the kinds of situation where they become dependent on someone in the settlement. They're friendly, people in the settlement.
Traders, churches, into the hands of fairly small local people who don't have any huge institutions behind them.
On the other hand, we've only been in the North in any sort of strength for about 12 or 13 years. And the Eskimos weathered worse things than civil servants and bureaucrats and the invasion of white foreigners. Northern development since 1954 is only the last in a sense.
Live in the land, when they come into the settlements, there's nothing they like better than to go to a church service, sing.
The Eskimo is no stranger to the white man. He has a good press image, of course. And I'm inclined to think we admire the Eskimo, not as a stereotype, but as someone who was able to sort of live and survive. Eskimos lived, hunted, and raised children.
In the settlement. And to the extent you do that, so much of your selfhood is given to the life there.
The man is definitely the head of the household, head of the society. A woman is only a woman. She has to stay in the background, and never do you find a woman.
I'm inclined to think if we will only look at the Eskimo, not as a quaint, funny little hunter or as an artist or all these ghastly cliches that cut up our literature, if we can only look upon him as a sort of a human being and adapt some of his ways of doing things, his culture, his values.
For instance, I couldn't really understand his attitude.
Rather than authoritarianism, a sense of community rather than a sense of individualism.
Of course, it's pretty unfair, I suppose, morally, to judge the past by today.
Made arrangements with another woman to take that particular baby after it was born. She would adopt the baby with the consent of her husband, of course. And they all very much hoped for a boy. Anyway, the woman came to the nursing station to have her baby, and it turned out to be a girl, to the disappointment of the whole group and the family.
But for today,
the frightening part,
it's not good enough.
Was the fact that they named the girl Carmala, which means a parasite, a worm, kind of because of the simple fact that she was a girl.
Paternalism in our and voice, after that, either. These are Canadian citizens, and let's face it, the igloo is not a part of Canadian life because the life expectancy of 27 years isn't a part of Canadian life.
You see, it makes sense to me to send Eskimos to the moon, simply because they're accustomed to living in isolation. They're accustomed to living enclosed for extended periods of time. If you look at the records of what happened in the Antarctic stations, where we had aggressive, individualistic white men huddled up together for a winter, there's some pretty grisly things came out of that.
If we don't sort of have committed themselves to settlement living, and particularly those who have received more than, say, grade 5 education, which is equivalent almost to...
I'd like to see Eskimos, for instance, employed as consultants in our school systems, telling our school kids exactly what it was like. I remember I watched my small daughter's Christmas play, or whatever it was. These things, you're never quite sure what they are in schools. And there the kids were sort of portraying Eskimos. And, I am a great hunter, I am an artist, etc. Well, of course, for most of the Eskimos, it would have been, I do jobs that no white man will do because they're either too low toast status or too, dirty. I'd like to see the Eskimos into the school system.
These are the people who are becoming the closest things that the Eskimos have to nationalists.
How it's changed. Gibberish on the printed page that was out of date at the time it was written.
We used to say in the early days of the new administration that our work would in effect show signs of success. When for the first time, and that's most of what I can say.
I am indeed a northern listener then. And the pity of it all is I'm not always able to select what I want to hear. I hear what other people inflict upon me. The noise of civilization and its discontents. No matter what we do to try and escape them, unless we select and understand and use what we hear, we are lost indeed. Not just lost listeners, but indeed lost people. I do believe that being able to select, I do believe that being able to reflect on that selection makes you more than the mere analyst that most of us claim we are. You see, I think the world is ridden with analysts. I think it's hag-ridden with self-appointed people that cut society apart and say, well, this part is worthless and this part is something else. In detaching and in reflecting and in listening, I suppose I'm able to synthesize, to have these different rails meet in the infinity that is our conscious hope.
Let's not kid ourselves. The North isn't going to be made up in future years of gigantic plastic bubbles surrounding Arctic villages with a cloak of warm air, and it isn't going to be modeled on at least what's represented as pretty highly scientific, rational northern towns of the Soviet Union. It isn't going to have the sort of flow of economic life of an Alaska, which is so largely based on a defense industry. I think the North in the future is going to look appallingly like the rest of Canada, and that's great as far as I'm concerned. It's going to look like suburbia. And with all the things that we deplore about suburbia, the silly Western ranch
I would think these towns, these communities would be built for the North and not for the suburbs of Toronto, as most of the communities in the North are at the present time. Once we get the jumbo jets and we get a few of the world's ills sorted out, I would expect that in the summer, the North would become a vast outdoor playground. We keep getting this lovely idea, which the Department of Indian Affairs and Northern Development's pursuing, that all of a sudden, all the wagons are going to line up along the 60th parallel.
But I don't quite see the argosies of magic sail in the North. I think that we're going to have to adapt from what's being developed for the rest of North America or for the rest of the world. Now, these adaptations are often quite considerable.
But with houses and hospital in the North, just to show that it's like the rest of Canada, well, my feeling is, if it's like the rest of Canada, why should anybody go there? The North, Alaska, Northwest Territories, and Yukon lie between three densely populated areas: North America, United States, and Southern Canada, China and Japan, and Northwest Europe. And right in the middle, plump, is this vast outdoor recreation area. This would be a place where people can actually sort of come and enjoy this. This is recreation, recreation, the chance to be alone, to be quiet in the North, which we desperately need in this rat race urban civilization. Though I'm a town man, I'm afraid. The chance to be alone and to be quiet with one's friends and one's family.
It's all the North can afford, so that's what they get. I wonder if things are really going to change that much in the future. We're not going to do really dramatic things like spending $100 million for a whole new approach to community living up in Resolute Bay. We're not going to build a kind of Arctic version of habitat around Tuktoyaktuk. We're not going to do so because that isn't quite the Canadian way, as well as for the very practical reason that the first government that suggests such a $500 million expenditure is going to find that the Treasury Board removes it from its next year's estimates in the first cuts. No, the general process of Canadian development, I think, is going to carry on in the North. We're going to do things that are dramatic in a way. We've already done things that are dramatic in the sense that we've had oil wells being drilled in the most inconceivable of places, virtually in the shadow of the pole. That's dramatic, all right. How many Canadians know about it? How many Canadians even know about such a dramatic story as running a telegraph line down that whole Mackenzie River, done in silence, while we're still looking at sixth-run movies about how they did it in the American West? Ye gods, we've done things in the North. But what we're not going to do in the North is things which, in the Canadian context, are a bit phony.
I would see our school kids going up there in the jumbo jets and learning biology by sort of looking at things and walking around, learning botany through the soles of their feet. I'm a geographer, and this is Strike's responsive chord. The North could be a kind of laboratory where we could, because we're an affluent society, we could take our time and involve people in solving these very complex problems of social change. Many of the problems of the underdeveloped world, for instance, how do you bring a very high level of science and technology into what we are pleased to call primitive areas among primitive people? And how do you do it in such a way that you don't harm or hurt people? This is very important.
The cash nexus in the North, far more than the South even, because so much of the North is financed by public funds which are scrutinized by Parliament, public funds that are in strong competition with funds for things far nearer home, the local subway or the nearest freeway and so on. This alone is a strong factor dictating towards conservatism in approach in design. Now, whenever an architect draws something that's really imaginative and bright and so on, this doesn't really necessarily bring us much closer to a new approach in the North. What really counts is not the architect's comment, it's the politician's comment, it's the administrator's comment, above all, it's the taxpayer's comment. But for most Canadians,
I'm talking about common problems. I'm not talking about what happens in Vladivostok or what happens in Fairbanks or what happens in Inuvik. I'm talking about common problems, and I'm admitting, as they are, that we know so very little about this spaceship Earth. And in the North, we can find out so much this sort of quest for El Dorado. It's so phony, it's so unreal in a sense, it's so anti-northern. The North is universal, it's a universal environment, you know. And the North makes you look at things on a global scale.
In any case, this man has just told me that this is what he's about to do. Now then, I have to answer in kind. Surely I have to tell him how I came to get stuffed away up there. Oh, this is a little harder, isn't it? Because here's a man that's got to live with himself. You must treat him tenderly. You can't let him have the North all in one barrel, so to speak. So what do you say? Well, what do you say? I suppose you sort of try and become truthful with yourself. This is tough. It's so nearly impossible that it takes all these miles and all this understanding and perhaps a need for human company. I'm just guessing now. This is hard to get at. Now, most of us have got a built-in sense of direction. This need have nothing to do with north or with any direction that is physical. We all have a gyro compass that gives us inner direction or a sense of possible purpose, certainly a sense of awareness that we don't properly understand ourselves. Now, this gyro compass I talk about is directional in this way, that it points us to a direction, but it rarely recognizes the landmarks. Very often, we travel in two ways. We travel either by pinpointing at some point in our journey, something where we can say, we've been there, we know this place. We go from the known securely to the unknown. So you begin by saying, we did, at least some of us thought that this was a challenge a while back. He looks at you sort of, surely it's a challenge now. I mean, this is the first time he's been on these rails that run north. You say, but then the challenge was different then. A few years back, certainly in human memory, people thought that this, what we call our North, presented a real challenge. Well, what form did they take? What form? As if everything must have somehow form that you can sort of put in words. This is hard. This is hard on you. He must notice that you're struggling a bit, eh? But what you're really saying then is something like this, that there was a time when the challenge was understandable. What challenge then? Here you have to take it easy. A certain William James then, perhaps at the turn of this, the 20th century, said that there was no moral equivalent of war. Well, I read that. There's no moral equivalent, said William James. No moral equivalent of war. That is that there's nothing like war for providing something for you to be against. Apparently, very few of us can afford to be for something. Apparently, all of us can afford to be against something. All right, then. So I can tell this chap, this research chap, heading north for Churchill, that that we can all be fellow men when we know what we're against. But what are we against in this situation where we're rolling north, these endless miles of steel, the clickety-clack of the rails, the punctuated monotony of the telegraph wires outside the day coach window, this and that, that make us at least fellow humans? Well, we're... I find it impossible to get this over except to say to this chap who is bound to listen because the miles are bound to stretch out and the night is going to fall endlessly, it seems. There's going to be a little place called Piquitanay at mile 214, and he'll wonder why the train is standing this long at that lonely spot. And the darkness of night's going to surround him, and then we're going to back up, and he's going to be twice perplexed. And in order to answer his perplexity, I'm going to say, the common enemy of both of us, whether it's now or yesterday or forever, you know? I suppose the common enemy is Mother Nature. Mother Nature. Oh, he says, for us. He's willing now to be a fellow traveler in my, of my imagination, eh? So I go on to say that the North is the war, that you can afford to be against Mother Nature if only humans make it possible. Well, he asks, what's wrong with that? What's good about that or bad about that? Well, I said, there was a time, believe me, in living memory again, when humans used to combine against Mother Nature, not only because they had to, but because in a sense there was a cleanness, a sureness, or a definiteness about coming up with Mother Nature that is lacking in our rootless pavements, in our, big city anonymity. You know, oh, he shrinks from this, and he's got to listen, though. See, remember, the train is barely pulling out. How many hours there are left in his mind, I've no idea. But perhaps he hasn't any idea either. Well, now, of course, I get into a complaining mood shortly after this. He looks at me questioningly, and my patience perhaps with myself, runs out. And I say, ah, yes, but that's, as I say, the North that was. No longer do humans combine to defy or to measure or to read or to understand or to live with this thing we call Mother Nature. Our number one enemy, instead of being Mother Nature, is, of course, human nature. It's crept stealthily from the south. Not necessarily by steel. All these long and endless miles that we've sort of passed. And now it's infected. It's infecting the North with a contagion that's, I don't know what it's like. I don't dare tell this person that it's that bad. I just indicate it. He's a nice fellow. You know, I don't want to destroy his dream. Also, I don't want to smash my own, which is paper thin at times. So, we're up against this William James. Moral equivalent of war, the equivalent of this war now is the North. This William James that wrote in Harvard this many years ago, whatever he did, I suppose he meant really that not war, the moral equivalent for us is going north.